This is the body, and this is the blood, broken and poured out for all of us. And in this communion, we share in His love. This is the body, and this is the blood.
Welcome to my kitchen and Kitchen Table Theology. Today I will discuss Holy Communion.
A few days ago, my 8-year-old son received his first Holy Communion in the Catholic Church.
About 4 years ago, we converted to Roman Catholicism. My boy was baptized in a Protestant church.
We were faced with the question, why can't his Protestant godparents receive communion in the Roman Catholic Church?
As a Protestant, I really had a problem with that issue.
When we would have communion at our Protestant church, our pastor would always announce, "At our church, everyone is welcome at the Lord's table."
But when invited to a Roman Catholic Mass, say for a wedding or a funeral, or for a first Holy Communion service, non-Catholic Christians are told that they must be Catholic in order to receive communion.
They feel rejected. So what do we tell them?
Well, there really are some very good explanations. For one thing, there is a fundamental difference between what Catholics believe about Holy Communion and what Protestants understand.
In fact, a lot of Catholics don't understand it either.
In the Catholic Church, the sacrament of the Eucharist involves transubstantiation, meaning that the substance or essence of the bread and wine changes in a very real way into the substance of the body and blood of Jesus. This is at the heart of Catholic Christian worship. It is why Holy Communion is celebrated at every Catholic Mass and is offered every day. For most Protestant Christians, communion is not understood to be the body and blood of Christ, but a sign or remembrance of His sacrifice on the cross.
But for Catholics, the Eucharist is Jesus. If you have any doubts about this, I suggest that you carefully study the Gospel of John, chapter 6.
I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, for the life of the world.
The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?"
Then Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you shall not have life in you. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood has everlasting life, and I will raise him up on the last day.
For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed.
He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him."
When a person receives the Eucharist during a Catholic Mass, it is an outward sign that he or she is in agreement with what the Catholic Church teaches.
Think about it. How can someone honestly receive communion in a Catholic Church if that person is not in communion with the Catholic Church? Now this leads to another very interesting reason why the Catholic Church only allows Catholics to receive communion.
It's to protect them.
"Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body, eats and drinks judgment upon himself."
We don't want people to eat and drink judgment on themselves.
See, the prohibition is actually very charitable.
And this goes for Catholics as well. If you are a Catholic and you are conscious of grave sin, you should not receive the Eucharist without first receiving the sacrament of penance and reconciliation.
Every Catholic should go to confession at least once a year. If they don't, they shouldn't receive the Eucharist. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man has great power in its effects. Before I became a Catholic, I was under the impression that this whole business about transubstantiation was dreamed up by the Catholic Church in the Middle Ages in an effort to control people and gain power. Something instrumental to my journey home to the Catholic Church was Christian church history. When you study early church history and the church fathers, you'll find that they believed in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. And the Eucharist was the center of worship in the early Christian church. One of my favorite characters from the early church was Ignatius. There's a lot of verifiable history surrounding this father of the early church. Ignatius lived in the first and second centuries. He was a disciple of John the Apostle. He knew Mary, the mother of Jesus. Ignatius was the third bishop of Antioch. That's the place where followers of Christ were first called Christians. Rome made Christianity a crime. Bishop Ignatius was arrested. He was eaten alive by lions in the Colosseum. But before that happened, he wrote many letters to the early Christian churches. Quote, "They abstain from the Eucharist and from prayer, because they confess not the Eucharist to be the flesh of our Savior Jesus Christ, which suffered for our sins, and which the Father of His goodness raised up again." Another early church father was Justin. "For not as common bread and common drink do we receive these, but in like manner as Jesus Christ our Savior, having been made flesh and blood for our salvation, so likewise have we been taught that the food which is blessed by the prayer of His word, and from which our blood and flesh by transmutation are nourished, is the flesh and blood of that Jesus who was made flesh. We call this food Eucharist, and no one else is permitted to partake of it, except one who believes our teaching to be true. If the body not be saved, then in fact neither did the Lord redeem us with His blood, and neither is the cup of the Eucharist the partaking of His blood, nor is the bread which we break the partaking of His body. He has declared the cup, a part of creation, to be His own blood, from which He causes our blood to flow. And the bread, a part of creation, He has established as His own body, from which He gives increase to our bodies." These early church teachings, the writings of the church fathers, dating back to the first and second century, clearly give us historical evidence that the Catholic Church did not dream this stuff up in the Middle Ages just to control people and gain power. If you have a problem with using early church history from sources other than the Bible to back up church doctrine, then I suggest that you view Kitchen Table Theology, Episode 2, Sola Scriptura, Bible Alone. And if you still absolutely cannot accept any teaching or historical evidence that's not contained in the Bible, then go to the Bible. Okay, say you're invited to a Jewish synagogue, and you're told not to go through the veil into the Holy of Holies, because only a high priest may enter into the presence of God. Now, would you say to them, "Well, I believe in God, and I'll enter His presence anytime I feel like it," and then just barge right in? So many things divide Christianity today. I don't think that what Jesus intended for His church was for there to be thousands of Christian denominations that disagree with each other about His teachings. These divisions among us are not the divine will of God, but are a result of people disagreeing with each other. this God allows, in accordance with God's permissible will, in giving us free will. But we need the guidance of the church to heal the wounds of division. Who decides what truth is? Do you desire a church where the teachings always agree with what you think? I want the truth. Thank you for tuning in to this episode of Kitchen Table Theology. May you be blessed by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, forever. And in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Can't you see?